Pentecost. That's the infilling of the Holy Spirit, 120. We're in the upper room because we need a return of Pentecost because of really where the earth is at, what God is wanting to do. But I like that she posted this on her Instagram, and I thought this kind of summed it up. She wrote, "We are Pentecostal believers. We pray in tongues publicly without shame. We lay hands on the sick and expect miracles. We preach with boldness to the culture, and we have confidence that at the name of Jesus, demons flee." Yeah, we're that. Pentecostal churches are on a comeback. Let's return to Pentecost. LOH Church tomorrow is going to be lit. I think it's been pretty lit. Don't you think it's been legit and it's been pretty lit? But I want you to see something in Ecclesiastes 1:9, if they would be so kind also to make sure that they put it up for those that maybe they didn't have their Bibles, and also they could follow along wherever you're watching around the world. But God is a God that oftentimes repeats himself. Now, there are times that he doesn't repeat himself, and it's what we call Renaissance. Anybody heard of the Renaissance movement? It means, you know, something that was new. They said that about Jesus in Matthew chapter 9, verse 33. They said, man, when he came in and he began to pray deliverance and cast out devils and heal the sick, they said in Matthew 9, we have never so seen this. This was a Renaissance. We've never so seen this in all of Israel. So, you know, a lot of times we hear words like awakening, we hear words like revival, words like reform, but we cannot rule out Renaissance. In other words, there's times where God does something that is absolutely different and absolutely new, in the sense, it's not like he's coming up with some, you know, new thing, but it is that maybe we haven't seen it in our generation, or maybe it's something that is, think about it, the Red Sea, have they ever seen that before? The parting of it? So God does at times Renaissance, something that you've never, ever seen or experienced before. But then predominantly how God does things is, we often say history repeats itself, but so does God. That's why there's four Gospels, for example. And they repeat sometimes many of the same stories, because we don't always get something the first time. Sometimes it takes repetition. But in Ecclesiastes 1:9, notice what it says. The thing that has been is what shall be again. And that which is done is that which shall be done again. And there's nothing new under the sun. So I want you to think about that. What has been shall be again. Go to Acts chapter 2. And let's talk about this return to Pentecost. That's when 120, including Jesus' mother, you can read that in Acts chapter 1, verse 14. It talks about the 120 that were there. I think it's verse 15. And it talks about Mary, the mother of Jesus, being there with his brethren. In other words, his brethren, his brothers and sisters were part of the 120 that were in the upper room. And you'll find out in Acts chapter 2 that they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they all began to speak in tongues also. So you can see in Acts chapter 2 what took place, but it's also what is going to be again. And so in order to know what's going to be again, you got to go back and see what was. And so I want to show you in Acts chapter 2 what happened on the day of Pentecost, that I believe there's a lot of things that we can glean truths from that is going to be again. In Acts chapter 2, it says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. That's why it's important that we gather together. That's why the enemy has attacked for the last year and a half, trying to keep churches from gathering. Because what did Jesus say? If two or more are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst. He also said that if two or more agree as touching any one thing, those of you that are watching, it shall be given to you, he said, by my Father in heaven. So if you are the devil, not calling you a devil, we may act like it sometimes, but we're not the devil, right? How many of you, if you were the devil and you knew that there is power in agreement, you would try to disrupt the assembling? Yeah, and that's what the enemy's been trying to do. So notice they were in one place and all in one accord. And now that word one accord, it's very important that you understand what one accord is. It's almost like if you were to line up in a straight line and lock your arms. How many of you ever played football before? And sometimes in practice you would do that, and you would run towards the other side, and they would come towards you, and you would block, you know, tackle, whatever. And this is kind of what it means, is it means to run together in unison. It's almost like in the context of where you're running and you're locking arms with one another and you're in a straight line, you're in formation, and you're running together in unison. And here's what it also means, a purposeful unison. It's not an accidental gathering, it's purposeful, where you are locking arms and running together, and you are step by step, in step with the person next to you. That's how much unity, that's how much unison there is. That's literally what it means. It also means a symphony. So if you're in one accord, how many know the band was in one accord? They have each individual instruments, but together they make up a sound, or they make up a symphony. And so that's what God wants. He wants His church to be made up of different folks, different people. Come on, He doesn't want black churches, white churches, Latino churches. He wants His church that's made up of all kinds of different talents and races. And let me say this, cultures. You know what I love about having a church, which is the church like we have here, is I love discovering other people's culture. You know why they like a certain food, why they like a certain way of dress, why they like this, why they like that. And it's awesome to learn from one another and to see things through somebody else's eyes and experience. It's very healthy. And I believe that's what makes for a healthy church. It's what makes for a healthy nation. But besides all of that, let's just go on now to verse 2, and let's look here. And suddenly, notice the word suddenly. So if that's what happened, do you think that if what has been shall be again, that we can expect suddenlies? Is there anybody here, those of you in chapel, those of you that are watching, that you have had a few delays? Anybody here, there's things that you're waiting on? If Pentecost and the Holy Spirit was about suddenlies, then I think we can say what has been is going to be again. We can expect sudden releases of God's power and blessing upon our lives. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. Now notice, is this quiet? A sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. How many of you noticed the wind and how it's been blowing? It's been rushing. It's been strong. It's been mighty. Those of you that are watching, now think about that. Is that loud? Yeah. Is the noise when it's coming with rushing mighty? It's loud. It's forceful. It's expressive. So if there's a return to Pentecost, it's going to require people who are not so reserved. Amen. Now, there is reverence. But most of us, you know, I grew up Lutheran. And I was telling this to the first service. You know, I grew up Lutheran, and I'm not making fun. I'm just telling you how it was. When we went to the Lutheran church, nobody was allowed to say anything unless it was scripted. Right? The pastor would get up, and sometimes he would sing, and he'd go, oh, I don't know if he was a singer or not, but he would sing, and he'd go, oh, merciful Heavenly Father. And we had a little piece of paper. Hear our prayer. And it was just with that kind of, I'm not making fun of it. That's how you express yourself. Because if you express yourself too loud and somebody next to you heard you, God would get you. That's what we used to think. And then he would pray a prayer. And Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. Hear our prayer. Well, you didn't even pray. He did all the praying. And you weren't even asked to pray along with him. And so it was dry. It was dead. It was boring. There was no life. You didn't want to move because God would get you. You couldn't say anything. If you sneezed in church, you couldn't even say, God bless you. You just had to hold the blessing till later and hold the sneeze. And I remember, man, I mean, we never saw anything supernatural. We used to think, you know, how many were ever, did you ever grow up in a denominational church and you were one of those acrolytes or acro, whatever they are, where you light the candles? What do they call that? Help me out. Acolyte. So you're an acolyte. And so you got the little pole, you know, with the flame on the end, and they light it. The pastor, the deacons would light it, and you'd have to go out there and you'd have to come down marching, and they'd have that organ. That, man, it scared me every time they played that thing. Dun, 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 dun. You're like, Walking into a funeral service, you're thinking that, you know, something's buried underneath the ground. It's going to come out and grab your foot while you're trying to walk. I mean, and I'm not making fun of it. That's how I thought. I was a kid. You know, I'm thinking there is something. And I would be carrying my little torch. And I was so scared. I didn't want to be in front of people. I had to wear a dress thing, looking thing. And I'm not making fun of it. I'm just telling you my story. If you think I'm making fun of it, bye, be blessed, be gone, click, you're out of here. So, and keep your comment to yourself, because I'm really not interested. So I would go up, and I remember I had to light the candles. And you know, they couldn't just give you like one candle. You mean you're like 12 years old. You never lit a candle before. You know, the only time I ever remember lighting candles is being an acolyte and getting married. You light candles. And so I'm trying to light this candle. There's like 12 candle operas on one side and 12 camera operas on one over here. And you don't want to be the dude that knocks them over. You ever had that? And so I was scared, man. I was nervous. And then when they told me, they said, you're going to be an acolyte or whatever that word is next Sunday. I was nervous because the girl the week before caught the little, there's like a little drape thing that drapes over the altar. Whatever that is, like a table runner. She caught that on fire, and the deacons had to come out and put it out. And I was like, I'm scared. I'm like, fire, stay where you're supposed to. And so I went up, and I started to light the candles. And what was amazing is somebody, when they put the candles out, mashed down the wick. So I'm up there trying to light the thing. And you talk about supernatural. That's about as supernatural as it got. And the lady's playing the organ. And it's the same chorus. And it's the hurry up, get done chorus. Dun, 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 dun. It's getting more intense, you know, and I'm trying to light this thing. But that was my experience. I grew up, never saw anything supernatural at all. How many of you, that was your story? And so you come into a charismatic type church, and you see somebody falling out under the power, you're like, oh my gosh, call a rescue squad. In fact, I got to tell you a story. How many of you ever heard of a man named Dr. Ed Dufresne? Yeah. So Dr. Ed Dufresne, he was a guy, he imparted a lot into Brendan and I. He was a crazy prophet, but he was so full of the Holy Ghost and power. So I had a dream when he was there. He used to preach for us. And this man, I mean, he would have major miracles that happened in his ministry. Angels would show up in the services and stuff. It was like nothing I'd ever seen. I saw people get, you know, thrown up against a wall and get pinned to the wall and they couldn't move. It was pretty cool, man. And so we were at Charleston's restaurant here in Omaha. How many of you have been to Charleston's? And so we're there, we're eating lunch. And I told Dr. Dufresne, I said, Dr. Dufresne, I had a dream about you last night. He said, really? Tell me the dream. So I started telling him the dream. That, you remember how he talked? And so I'm telling him the dream, and all of a sudden he goes, whoo, shoo, shoo, shoo. I'm like, what? What? He's going, this is like 25 years ago. Shoo, shoo. Glory. Yes, Lord, I see it. I see it, Lord. Shoo, shoo. And he falls out under the power in the middle of Charleston's right in the aisle. I'm like, no, you did not. And all of a sudden you could see the lady and the man in the booth next. They're like, and he drops out in the middle. And so the happy little waiter guy comes out with his little tray. And he's like, shall I call an ambulance? I'm like, I don't know, man. I don't know if he checked out. I don't know. He wasn't moving. He was just laying there. And so I said, I think he's okay. You sure you want me to call an ambulance? I think he's okay. So all of a sudden the guy goes, okay. And he takes his tray back. The manager comes out and says, sir, is this your father? I said, I don't know that dude. You know, I was just sitting here right by the. And so I'm sitting there and I'm looking at him. I'm like, yeah, he's the guest speaker. He's like, we're. It's classified. So he said, I'm going to go ahead and call the squad. He's alive, right? And I'm like, I think he'll be okay. Just give him about, you know, 5 minutes. He is out under the power of God. And so the manager said, well, if he's not up in, you know, 5 minutes, I guess I'm going to call the squad. I said, just leave him alone. I think he's with God. But how do you explain something like that? And so You know, my experience into Pentecost was kind of amazing. I mean, I would be in some of his services, and the glory of God would be so strong. Again, you got to understand, the man, the little boy with the acolyte trying to light candles, you know, and then if the flame would go out, you think, God was here, right? And that was your level of supernatural, not some guy falling under the power of Charleston's. But I remember being in services, man, and people would be frozen in the power of God. That happened to me one time. How many were in the service one time where literally I was froze in the power of God? Now, I'm not trying to be strange. It's actually in the Bible, and in the book of Ezekiel will show you where there's different signs and wonders that can happen. But there was one service where I was literally frozen. I could not walk. I could not move. They even had ushers trying to lift my legs up. They could not. Just like almost like that dude that was up here that happened to him. And people, you remember that they would go by in a line and God would begin to minister and heal them. And I couldn't move. And you know what? I long for that return of that kind of glory. I was telling the first service, can you imagine, men? Your wife comes up with her honey-do list. You know, you got to clean the windows, mow the lawn. You got to clean the garage out. You got to do the dishes. All you have to do, dudes, is just go, the glory's here. Honey, I can't move. I can't even get my arms up to here. And you watch. There's no honey-do, man. It works every time. And then when they're gone, it's amazing how the Lord will just loose you from that frozen position. I was telling the first service this. You know, talking about the supernatural. You know, you have to come to a place in your life where you don't resist the supernatural. You've got to be receiving of it or be open to it. We'll talk about that in a moment. And so I was teaching on the blood of Jesus and in the church. And Matthew was a pretty little guy. He was probably, I don't know, 18. No, he was a little guy. And I was teaching on the blood of Jesus. And I was talking about how the blood was shed. But you could plead the blood. How many of you plead the blood? Oh, you're awesome. You should plead the blood. In other words, that's your right. That's your privilege. As a Christian, to say, I plead the blood. In other words, you're claiming your legal right to be protected, to be healed, to be delivered. And so I was preaching on how you can plead the blood and how the blood protects you. Well, he was goofing off in the front row. And so, you know, how many of you dads have signals? Wives, we know your signals. How many of you guys have been kicked underneath the table before, you know? It's like you're sitting there in a conversation, you jump up. And Brenda and I do that. You know, if we're, you know, we kick each other and play footsie also. But anyway, so he's goofing off in the front row, and I'm trying to get his attention. I'm like, And everybody, you know, thinking I'm manifesting a demon. I'm like, they're up there. What's Pastor doing? Pressed down, shaking together, running over? No, I'm sending signs to my son. And so finally, we get home. I said, Matthew, go to your room. He's a little guy. He's probably 7. Okay. He goes to his room. And I said, you know what to do. Now, if you don't like my methods of disciplining, it was a long time ago. Don't write about it. I don't care. Bye. So anyway, I walk in. And Matthew knew exactly what to do. He had to get himself in spanking position. And something had to show. Blessed assurance. My backside is mine. And so I grabbed what I was going to spank him with. And I said, all right, son, you ready? Now, you know, you don't goof off in church. You're going to get spanked for that. He's crying. Don't feel so bad for him. He turned out great. And so I had the spanking thing, and I was getting ready to spank him. And all of a sudden, he turns around, and he said, I plead the blood. Man, I was like, ding. And the spanking device. Mic drop. I looked at my son. Have a good day, son. But then there was one time where he was goofing off again a few weeks later. And so I was doing the same thing. And he wouldn't listen. So I finally said to the people, excuse me, Matthew, come with me. I stopped the sermon, took him in the back room. You remember that?
Yeah, I forgot that.
You forgot that. And he didn't plead the blood then either. But he never did that again. So anyway, let's go on. Don't you want to see days like that with the glory of God? And so there appeared, verse 3, unto them cloven tongues like a fire. Well, first of all, let me back up. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like a fire, and it sat on each of them. Now notice it said it sat on each of them. So there was not one person that was left out. Notice it says they all began to speak in tongues, verse 4. So, you know, sometimes you hear teaching today that it's for some and not for everybody. Well, that's not what the Bible shows. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they all began to speak in tongues. Watch this. They didn't make up the words. The Holy Spirit gave them utterance. Now, watch this. Verse 5. And they were dwelling at Jerusalem, Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. So you could say that there was a lot of folk, yes or no? You could also say that God waited until he had a crowd. He waited until he had an audience. Now here's why this is important. If there's going to come a return to Pentecost, pastors, preachers, churches cannot make it, and I'm not saying this critically, so don't hear that. It cannot be about the people. It has to be about God. And then it has to be about the people. What am I saying? It can't be. I've had pastors say, well, we just don't allow any of that Pentecostal stuff in our church. And these are people that used to have Holy Spirit type churches. Or they would say, well, we just don't let anyone speak in tongues on Sunday. We'll scare somebody. We don't allow any signs, wonders, and miracles on Sunday because we don't want to offend anyone or scare people away. That's not what happened on the day of Pentecost. It is saying there was one person in Jerusalem, and God poured out his spirit, and that person ran to Ethiopia. Didn't say that. God had a whole crowd of people. He waited until he had an audience so that God could show up, show off. He's not afraid. In fact, if you keep reading in the book of Acts, 3,000 were added to the church. And here's the thing. Today, churches brag how they're growing, and they're growing fast, and they got this and that. And I want to say, yeah, but if your drawing card is your coffee and donuts, you're not Pentecost. Because what grew the churches in the book of Acts was the power of God. Signs, wonders, and miracles. Not the Jerusalem coffee of Hebrews. So let's keep reading. So there was all these people dwelling out of Jerusalem. And it goes on and it lists all the different people that were there. Now here's the thing that you have to understand. Verse 12 and verse 13 sizes up, or really it explains it. You're going to have in every service, in every situation, there's going to be those that are receivers and there's those that are resistors. If you want to have the supernatural power of God displayed in your life, if you want to receive healing, if you want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, if you want to be saved, if you want to come into more deeper things with God, you got to be a receiver. Why do you think when you go to an Oral Roberts meeting back in those days, or Brother Hagin, or you'd go to a Benny Hinn meeting, he would always be, close your eyes, worship the Lord, right? Sorry, Benny. But anyway, worship the Lord. And he would have you focus on God because he's trying to get you in a position of receiving. Because think about it. If the more people that receive and get in receiving mode, the more agreement is added in the natural and the spirit. And that's how God likes to move. Can you imagine the level of miracles? The level of the presence of God, if more people would not just stand and either resist or reject, but they would be like, whoa, what meaneth this? Look at, that's exactly what they did. They were in receiving mode. And verse 12, and they were amazed and were in doubt, saying to one another, whoa, what meaneth this? See, that's the attitude that you got to have. Listen, when I got saved back in 1984, I will never, ever forget it. I remember I got saved, and then they told me, they said, well, you need to come back next week and be filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm like, well, all right, what is that? They said, you're going to speak in tongues, and you need to ask the Holy Spirit to fill you. And so all week long, I kept saying, Holy Spirit, fill me. I didn't even know what I was asking for. And I just asked them, I said, just show me in the Bible. Man, they showed me Acts 1:8, you'll receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you. They showed me Acts 2. That was good enough for me. It was in the Bible. I wanted it. All week long, I paced my floor saying, God, I want this Holy Ghost. And then when the service ended, the week later, I came. It was after service. My spiritual mom, Germaine Saucier, she lived to be 100 years of age, laid her hands on me. And I'm telling you, it was not just one word or two little words or syllables. It was like a river of living water. It was so much that I could not shut it off. And I went back to my house that night, and because it was an evening service, and I could not shut it off. And God gave me a vision, took me up into heaven. Now, Kat, it wasn't like you, where you saw the seraphims, the creatures, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. You saw Moses and Enoch. You know, all I saw was light. I saw the Father who was on the throne. He reached out his hand and he touched me and he commissioned me as a prophetic voice to the nation and to the nations. And that's how it started. And my mom was yelling at the top of the stairs trying to get my attention, and I was caught up, man. Now that was my experience. May not be your experience. But it came not from resisting. It came from receiving. I was like, God. That's why Jesus said, unless you become like a child, you cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. That's why when I used to, you know, be at the job and somebody would be sick, I would pray for them. And I would believe God for miracles, still do. Because you have to have an attitude in your life. I'm a receiver. I have the power of God in my life. It's not up to me to heal the sick, to deliver the captive. I am just a conduit. I'm just somebody that the power is flowing through. But if you just always go like this, you're never going to receive anything. Look at verse 12, 13. These are the resistors. And then others began to mock, saying, these men are full of new wine. But then here's verse 14. This is why whenever the supernatural begins to flow in a church, I think it's smart for the pastor to watch this. Verse 14, Peter is not apologetic. Okay? There was a day I was apologetic. When I first started pastoring, I'd say, well, you know, there's a method to our madness. There's a reason we do what we do here. Like, I'm apologizing. God showed up, right? Somebody got thrown across the room. Right? You know, lady got her makeup messed up, whatever. I'd apologize. God would prophesy about the nation. I'd apologize. Well, this was, you know. No, you don't have to apologize. Peter did not stand up and say, can I have everyone's attention? I am so sorry that this has happened. I'm the same dude that denied Jesus 3 times. I don't understand what happened. No, man, he stood up full of the Holy Ghost. He had a boldness. That's part of a return to Pentecost, is a boldness and an authority that will come from our pulpits. And he stands up and he says, look, man, these men are not drunk as you suppose. So he starts explaining it. Verse 15. And look at verse 16. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, that it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God. Saith who?
God.
I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. So in other words, if we're going to have a return to Pentecost, our services should not be about, you know, a set agenda that God can't move and adjust, or we won't adjust with God. So the day of Pentecost came, and he's going to pour out his spirit upon all flesh. Now watch this. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. How many of you are young? And your young men shall see visions. I remember, man, I would pray this. I saw this in the Bible when I got saved at 18, and I would sit there and go, okay, Lord, young men are going to prophesy. I didn't even know what prophecy was, but I said, God, I want to prophesy. I want to do what the Bible says. It's the last days. I want to be a part of that. I'm a young man. I want visions, God. And one day I'll be old and I want dreams. Now God has given me dreams and he gives me visions. I've seen Jesus. I've talked to Jesus. I've visited with him. I've seen angels. I've seen demons. Come on, are you listening? Because what I would do is I would receive. I would be so hungry, saying, God, you put this in the Bible. And you said in the last days there is coming an increase of the prophetic. Sons and daughters prophesying. Come on. Dreams, vision, that's all prophetic. Now you say, well, Pastor Hank, how do I prophesy? Listen, the day of Pentecost is the way that you prophesy or you communicate the heart of God. If you want to know how God operates or how you hear God and how you communicate God, notice it's found in three primary ways that God communicates. It's something you see, something you hear, and something you feel. Let's go back to Acts chapter 2 here, the first part. Notice, and suddenly there came a sound. So what is that? Something you hear. And it began to come as a rushing mighty wind. Do you feel the wind? Yes. So then it's something you not only hear, but it's something that you feel. So God communicates by something you might hear, a thought, something you feel, something you perceive, something you sense. And then how many of you know also something that you see? And they saw cloven tongues like a fire. So when you want to prophesy or move in the Spirit, always remember the three primary ways that God will use you. Something you see, come on, tongues of fire. Something you hear, a rushing mighty wind. Something you feel. You feel the wind or you feel something. How many got that? Now let's move on for the sake of time. And so he says, old men shall dream dreams. How many of you are old men or older men? How many are over 40? Okay, so you're older by way of age. Listen, I said this in the first service. How many of you remember, those of you that are like over 35, you know, Mr. Magoo? Remember him? We don't want a Mr. Magoo spirit. Once you get a certain age, remember Mr. Magoo, he was always like, I can't see you, Lord. I can't hear you. Where are you, God? You don't want to walk in a Mr. Magoo spirit. I mean, you need to be about dreams. You need to be about visions. You need to be about hearing and seeing and sensing what God is saying. And so that's part of a return to Pentecost. It's not only an increase of prophetic gifting and anointings, but it's an increase of the ability to hear God, see God, feel what He's saying. And that's what we need to strive for. Amen? Now look at this. And upon, verse 18, my servants and upon my handmaids, I'll pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall what? Again, verse 18, notice, prophesy again. You say, well, what is prophecy? Well, according to the Bible, in 1 Corinthians 14, it's exhortation, encouragement, it's edification, building up, and it's comfort. But really, to prophesy something is to prophesy God's heart, mind, will, and intent. That's mostly for the prophet's office. That's why it's at a higher level than just exhortation, edification, and comfort. But let's go on. I want you to see something. Verse 19, and I'll show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath. Blood, fire, vapor of smoke. Now you get the doom and gloom people. They're automatically going, oh, see, that means everything's done. Everything's over. Blood, it's going to be bloody. Civil wars, fires, things on fire, and smoke. And nothing remains. But I think you got to look at it from the standpoint of prophetic. I believe that we are coming into such a return of Pentecost. We're coming into such a move of God that there's going to be blood. There's going to be salvations, mass salvations, billions of people getting saved. Fire, fire of the Holy Ghost. I believe it's also God's judgments on some things, but I also believe it's a passion. It's a fire on the inside of us, a desire and a call for rightness and for righteousness. And the vapor of smoke, I believe, is the glory of God. And then the sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood. Well, we saw that and they wrote their books about it. And when it didn't happen, nobody called them false. Before that great and notable day of the Lord. See, we always focus on blood, fire, vapor of smoke, darkness, you know, the sun and moon, blood moons. But why won't we talk about the great and notable day of the Lord? Do you not think that before this day that there can't be another great and notable days that God shows up and does something in a generation? Look at verse 21. We're almost done. It shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now we're going to see mass salvations. Acts 16:31. You know what Noah's Ark was about? What was Noah's Ark about? Somebody sent me a meme yesterday. In fact, it was Richard Roberts. And he gave me this meme, and they, meme. And there was two dinosaurs that were looking, and Noah's Ark was off in the distance. They went, oh, man, we missed it. That's why they're extinct. How many got that? They didn't discern. But we often think that Noah's Ark is about saving the animals. And it is. You know, we love animals, right? But really, Noah's Ark was about saving of a family that wound up saving the whole world. And so God wants to save your family. So whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's not just salvations for other people. Come on, you need to believe God for your loved ones. Acts 16:31, believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. Watch this. And your family as well. In Exodus 12, they were instructed, the father, to grab a hold of a lamb for a house. Because God wanted the whole house to be saved. Exodus 12 in the first Passover. God wants your whole family. And listen, I don't care if you're at war with them. You need to say, God, they are not allowed to go to hell until they make a decision to accept the risen, ascended Christ. Amen? So now look, let's go on. I'm going to make it very quick. Verse 22, Peter stands up. And he begins to talk about Jesus approved in signs, wonders, and miracles. Now, look, notice his message now. You can read it from 22 down to 36, where we're going to pick up in verse 36 for the sake of time. Therefore, let all the house of Israel assuredly that God has made that same Jesus whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Do you know what Pentecostal preaching was? It wasn't a mixture of words. It wasn't just nice little preaching. I don't want to offend anyone. I don't want to stir anyone. I don't want to confront anything. That's why Jesus said in Matthew 11, when he was talking to the people, he said, man, what did you come out to see? And he was talking about John the Baptist. He said, did you come to see a reed that bends towards, you know, if the wind blows, it bends and moves according to the wind. In other words, it moves with trends. Did you come, he was speaking of John the Baptist, to see a king that is clothed in soft linen? In other words, people want it nice. They want soft presentation. And Jesus is saying, listen, what should we like in this generation? They want it nice. They want to go with trends. But there comes a point where not every sermon has to be in your face, but there has to come, if a return of Pentecost is going to come, it will have to confront the culture. It'll have to confront. Otherwise, there's no conversion of your soul, your mind. You will think like the media. You will think like the culture. And what people don't realize is Jesus said, you're not of this world. Amen. Scripture also says you're aliens, not an alien with green buggy eyes and all that. But you're an alien. You're not of this world. And the problem is we are not called as Christians, if they'll come to the piano, you're not called to be subcultural. You know what that means? This is the problem. This is where a lot of churches, why they don't come into Pentecostal power. You know why? Because whatever the culture says, if the culture, you know, is moving towards, you know, marrying people of same sex, then that's the way they're going to flow. Whatever the culture is, they're going to come underneath that and become subcultural. The body of Christ is called to be kingdom culture, and that is what we call countercultural. They have to conform to us. Are you listening? Or they will never be converted. So let's go on. Watch this now. So Peter preaches and he says, this Christ whom you crucified. Can you imagine how bold here this man that denied Jesus three times is now saying and pointing the finger at them saying, look, this Christ whom you crucified. And I think this, listen, how many of you ever heard some good old preaching? I remember guys like R.W. Shambach. Anybody know R.W. Shambach? Raise your hand. I mean, he would preach and your whole bones would rattle. Lester Summerall would preach and your bones would rattle. Rod Parsley, well, praise God, you know, Rod Parsley. But he would preach and your bones would rattle. And there was an authority. And you would be pricked in your heart. Now listen to me. I remember years and years ago, and I don't watch him, so I don't know what he's like now. And this isn't to judge anybody, but I remember when God used Jimmy Swaggart to push back evil and darkness on this nation. We're not here to discuss what happened, what he did, but I'm telling you, when that man would preach, I'm telling you, no wonder devils went after him. He had such an anointing upon his life to speak against the culture, speak against evil. Amen? And I'm telling you, I think in those days, in the late 80s, that there was a whole lot more Christians that were more aware. Two things contributed to what I feel like was more holiness than what I see today. Number one, everybody thought Jesus was coming in 84. And then when it didn't happen, it was 88 reasons. Then it turned to 89. So we thought we were in trouble. We were going to get left behind or get kicked in it, one of the two. And so We were scared. The second thing is we had preachers like that, that would preach messages that would prick your hearts. Where you would walk out of church going, man, I want to change. I want more of God. Now I think social media has kind of added to a lot of that. Okay, let's close this thing up. But I want you to see in closing, it will be my only closing. Peter said unto them, repent. Some of you know that comes. Repentance comes through what? The blood. Change your lifestyle. Now people, they get frustrated with repentance. They're like, well, I tried to repent. Well, there's a difference between telling God, like I did something one time where the Lord had told me to be quiet. And I didn't. I was talking about somebody years ago, and God said, be quiet. And I kept talking. And then he told me, he said, shut up. I've had the Lord tell me to shut up. You ever had the Lord tell you that? I've had my wife tell me that, and I've had the Lord, and I don't like either one telling me that. But I was running my mouth, and God told me to shut up, and I knew I grieved the Lord. And so I couldn't wait to get back to a time of privacy with the Lord. And I said, Lord, I'm really sorry, man. I am so sorry that I didn't listen there. And God was very bold with me. He said, I am not interested in your apologies. Because he had been trying to get my attention. Now, if you are really sorry and you feel bad about it, but listen, feeling bad about your sin, feeling bad about what you did, that's a starting point, but it isn't what's going to cause you to go to a whole nother level of righteousness in your life. You gotta repent. You gotta turn. Now you say, well, how do I repent? Jesus said, bring forth, how's it go? Meat, fruit that is meat for a repentance. How does a fruit get to become a fruit? Seeds. You just take daily choices. That's why it says, sow to yourself righteousness. Make daily, hourly decisions to do what's right. Try it. And you'll see that you'll start developing fruit in it. Where you're like, man, I don't want to do that anymore. I don't want to say that anymore. I don't want to be like that anymore. It'll work in your life. So it talks about the blood. Second, notice what he talks about. Be baptized. That's water baptism. Now, it's not talking about, you know, when you get baptized as a baby, because there's no, in Scripture, there's no infant baptisms. There's infant and child dedications. But it's when you become a Christian and you are truly converted that you need to be baptized in water, immersed, down with your old life. That's what you're saying, right? And all your sins, and up in the newness of life as a new creature in Christ Jesus. But then Peter goes on and he says this, for this promise is unto you, to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as the Lord our God shall call. So the third thing is, first is repentance, that's the blood. Second is water baptism. And third is, are you ready? The infilling of the Holy Spirit. Now last scripture, stand to your feet. 1 John chapter 5, verses 7 and 8. How many want to agree with God? How many want to be in agreement with God? You know, there's things that sometimes I pray about and I'm like, Lord, I will do whatever you want me to do. And I know in my heart that there's like six, seven things that doesn't count that I won't do. Have you ever had that? I'm the only one. Okay, I'm just being honest, man. I've been checking my heart. Like, if I'm going to say, God, I will do your will, then I better make sure that I do it. Because I want God to, here's the thing. I want God to keep me on a short leash. Come on, when I walk my three German shepherds, they have to walk in command. I don't let them, you know, there's people that walk their dogs with a leash about as long as 40 feet, 100 feet, and their dog's running them. You never let your dog walk in front of you. If you let your dog walk in front of you, they don't respect you. You don't have three German shepherds, then they better respect you. And so they have to walk next to me. They have to walk and do what I say. Now they don't. Now listen. They're not robots. These are my buds, man. They're my family. They're my dogders and dog son. But my point is, they know that if they act up, I'll jerk their leash, and I communicate how I'm happy with something through the leash, or I let them know my objection. I want God. The higher you go in the things of God, how many of you feel the call of God in your life? Those of you that are watching, you need to pray prayers. Lord, jerk my leash. Keep me on a short leash. In other words, if you're starting to get into anger or unforgiveness, or you're talking about somebody, let God jerk you, man. Where you feel that tug, like, no, I better not say that. Better not do that. I pray that with my wife because, you know, I love her and I want to honor her. You know, and if I, You know, there's times where Brenda and I, you know, we've been married 32 years, but I'll look at her and say, well, do you really want to argue? No, I don't want to argue. Okay, let's make up. And I give her the olive branch. She gives me the olive branch, and it's over. Right? So stay on a short leash. But here's the point. 1 John 5:7. There are three that agree in heaven that you need to hear. In heaven, there is the Father. There's the Word, which is Jesus, right? He is the Word that became flesh, dwelt among us, and the Holy Ghost. Last scripture, verse 8. And there are three that agree or bear witness in the earth. Watch this. The Spirit, that's the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Water, which is not only the Word of God, but it's also baptism. And the blood, which is salvation. So if you're going to be a true converted Christian, and you're going to be a Christian that wants a restoration of Pentecost in your life, you need to be a Christian that's Spirit-filled, water-baptized, and come on. You know the power of the blood, forgiveness, pleading. Now, those aren't requirements for heaven except the blood, but I am telling you, you need to get in agreement with God. Don't just make it about the blood only. You know, you got a lot of denominations out there that make it about the blood and water. Oh, yeah, we're saved, we're baptized. Yeah, but are you filled with the Holy Ghost? You speak in tongues? No, you need all three. They're in agreement. So you need to be, right? Christian saved by the blood, baptized, immersed in water, and full of the Holy Ghost and power. Amen. Pastor Doug, would you come up? Altar team, would you come up? I'm going to close like 1 minute, man, because I went long, and I want you to know that I respect your time. I'm not apologetic because God moved here today. But if you're here today and you've never asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart, or maybe you want to rededicate your life, I could have you bow your head, close your eyes, do all of that. But I want to know, and God wants to know, that it's going to stick, that you really are serious about it. You know, how bad do you want God? If you really want the Lord, you want to be saved, then I'm asking you, when I dismiss service, you just walk right out, come down and say, you know what, I want to rededicate my life, or I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here today, you've given your life to Jesus Christ, but you're not filled with the Holy Spirit. And you want to speak in tongues. And you're watching. It's not that hard. You just simply say, Jesus, come in my heart. Forgive